Good morning, everybody. Good to see all of you. Come on in and have a seat. I want to welcome everyone here. If you're visiting with us today, we're delighted that you are in the house of the Lord with the people of the Lord to give glory to the Lord this morning. It's a good day. The day the Lord has made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. First order of business is to welcome some four-year-olds who have outgrown the nursery. So they'll be in here with us. Pray for their parents. Liddy Lamb, is Liddy here? Liddy, come on up. Where are you, Liddy? Coming in right there. I see her. This is the little girl that's going to be in charge when she grows up. Come on down here, Liddy. Miss Denise has a, what's in there?
There's a Bible and some crayons and a little piece of paper.
Bible, crayons, piece of paper, keep you busy. That's great. Come stand right by me, Liddy. Would you do that? And then we've got Elizabeth Mangus. Oh, boy. She's happy to be here. Can y'all see them? Move up this back one more step. There you go. Henry Martin. Where's Henry? Henry. Oh, here he comes. Atta boy. Brave. That's a good boy. You want me to stand? That's a good boy. Good boy. Yes, sir. Rod Shearer is right here. Rod Shearer, not here. All right, how about Hannah Thomas. Well, I'll take those, and while Heath preaches, I'll color and just kidding there, Heath. All right, well, we're sorry we missed two of them, but welcome to church. That's the way, welcome to church. We're very glad to have you. Yes, we are. that's good. Let me say a quick prayer for them. Father, we thank you for these little ones, and as well as the two that aren't here, and we pray your blessings on them. We thank you for their lives and pray that even at this young age that they will know you and be known by you and come to love you and worship you in spirit and in truth. Bless their parents as they strive to raise them in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Bless their efforts. And we pray that through word and sacrament, these children will grow to be great men and women of God, to love you and serve you all the days of their lives. Through Christ our Lord we pray. Amen. All right, I know you're ready to go back to your seats, so thank you so much. So very brave. While they go back to their seats, please make a note that next Sunday we have Dr. Brian Chappell here with us. I know it's a holiday weekend, but come back from the lake, or don't go in the first place. And Brian's a friend of mine, and man who believes the Bible is the Word of God and a very gifted communicator of the Word of God. So you'll enjoy hearing him. And do any of you have friends? Anybody have a friend? You've got one. Okay. Invite your friend, particularly if you have friends that are not in church or are looking for a church home. Invite them, and let's use this as a great outreach opportunity. Choir practice starts this Wednesday night, and there's few empty chairs. That's not the whole choir there, of course, but let's get over 50, okay? I think he's got 42 on the roll, and I know there's 8 more out there that love to sing. So this Wednesday night, choir practice begins. Then Catfish and Calvinism, would like you to make a note of that. We'll kick off our Wednesday night series September the 14th. You can go online and register now. And we'll have the Catfish at 5:15, the Bible study at 6 o'clock, and a good time will be had by all. So again, invite your friends to that gala event, and let us now prepare our hearts to worship the Lord. Psalmist says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Let's exalt his name together as we sing together hymn number 578. Heavenly Father, we gather this morning to let our joys be known, for you have brought great gladness to our hearts. And so receive glory and honor, praise and adoration as we gather together through our Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Well, I've again found that the word of the Lord is true. He builds his church and nothing stops him. And I'm going to prove that to you this morning as I introduce this wonderful group of new members, beginning with Linda Adams. Come stand right by me, Linda. I'd tell you about each of these, but we'd be here all day. So I won't say anything other than your name. How's that? Linda Adams, we're glad to have you. And Ike and Roberta Bradley. And Daniel and Natasha Newman. I will say Daniel and Natasha have four of the nicest dressed children you'll ever see. Y'all scoot down this way. You're on TV now, so we got to get you in the center of the, yeah, right here on this step here, right there. Yeah, it's okay. It's all right. All right, Sue Reeves, not far away. And Hunter and Debney Smith. And Don and Cynthia Van Ryan. We might better move down this way a little bit. This is crowd management. You're doing great. I told you it'd be painless, right? And Cliff, Rhonda, and George Walker. And while you come forward, I've been threatened with my life if I don't remind you that you're supposed to have your pictures made by the cafe after the service. So remember that. Y'all look great, and good time to get your picture made. Welcome to the church. We're happy to have all of you.
I'll now read you the vows for membership and ask that you reply with, I do. Do you acknowledge yourselves to be sinners in the sight of God, justly deserving his displeasure, and without hope, save in his sovereign mercy, do you? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners, and do you receive and rest upon him alone for salvation as he is offered in the gospel, do you? Do you resolve and promise, in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit, that you will endeavor to live as becometh the followers of Christ? Do you? Do you promise to support the church in its worship and work to the best of your ability? Do you? Do you respect the government and discipline of the church and promise to promote its purity and peace? Do you?
Stand with me as we pray together. Father, thank you for these new members. We thank you for bringing them into our fellowship, and we know that you've done so for a reason, and a good reason. And so we thank you for the gifts that they have, and the love for you that they have, and all the things that they bring to help further the ministry of our church. And may we know them well, and they us, and may we together be a strong family of believers. Help us, we pray, to bear each other's burdens. Help us to sharpen each other like iron sharpens iron, that we may love each other well, and that the world may know we're believers by the love we have for one another. As we marching through Emmanuel's grounds to fairer worlds on high, give us grace and fill us with your Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated and return to your seats. Thank you. Our New Testament lesson is found in 2 Corinthians. Please turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. And let us hear the word of God through the Apostle Paul to the church in Corinth. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God that is at Corinth, with all the saints who are in the whole of Achaia, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as we share abundantly in Christ's sufferings, so through Christ we share abundantly in comfort too. If we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation. And if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which you experience when you patiently endure the same sufferings that we suffer. Our hope for you is unshaken, for we know that as you share in our sufferings, you will also share in our comfort. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. As we gather to worship, we remember that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And we remember that our God is a consuming fire. And therefore, we are to worship him with reverence and awe. To that end, we bow before him to confess our sin and seek once again his grace and favor. Together we pray. Father of mercies and God of all comfort, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We confess that we justly deserve your displeasure and are without hope save in your sovereign mercy. Lord, have mercy on us, sinners. Forgive us, accept us, and renew us for the sake of the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask this in his name. Amen. Our Father in heaven, we give thanks that you are near to all who call on you. And so we call. We call and we plead for your grace and favor and mercy, your love, which is from everlasting to everlasting. We come as people who are afflicted with the cares of the world, bearing many burdens. We come, some of us fearful, some of us anxious, some of us of little faith, all of us needing more faith, and some of lukewarm hearts. So we pray that you would send your Spirit afresh to strengthen and embolden us, and kindle within our hearts a fervor to serve you and worship you and to speak of you, to tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of our Lord. Increase our faith and destroy our fear, for you've not given us a spirit of fear, but one of power and love and of a sound mind. We pray for Rob Michaels. You'd continue the healing process you've begun with him and Tim Cummings and Larry Warren and Bob Watterson. We continue to pray for Susie Bain, for Hazel O'Donnell and Catherine Huddleston. We pray for Gabe Parnell's brother. We pray for others that are sick, or have tests, have reasons to be concerned. Lord, you've said, let not your hearts be troubled. Paul says, you're the God of all comfort. So comfort us, strengthen us, bless us. May the Son of Righteousness rise with healing in its wings. Heal our country, we pray. You've blessed us in so many ways, and there are many wonderful things about our country, but there is a sickness as well. And so we pray that you would have mercy, and that your word would spread far and wide into the hearts of men and women, you would do a great work. You would hallow your name, and you would lift high the cross in our country. Bless our leaders. Spare us from foolishness. Spare us from arrogance. Give us humble men and women that look to you for guidance and wisdom, for we know the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Bless our missionaries. We know they're often out of sight and out of mind, but keep them on our hearts, we pray, and use them mightily, for we know the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. But we know you can do great things through few, and so reap a great harvest of souls for your honor and glory, we pray. Thank you for the unspeakable gift of your Son, who came to seek and save the lost and give his life a ransom for many, including us. And we ask you to hear us now as we pray, as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The humbling reality is that none of us would be here today were it not for the grace of the Lord. We'd be doing things that we thought were more fun, more important, but the fact is that the Lord has worked in our hearts and called us out of darkness into his marvelous light and into his everlasting kingdom, and that's why we are here today. He came to seek and save the lost, to seek us, to look for us, and save us, and give his life a ransom for many. And thus does the Apostle Paul remind us these well-known words, "For by grace you've been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Many of you know the name Charles Colson. You may remember that he was an aide to President Nixon back in the 70s. He was nicknamed the Hatchet Man. He was known for being extremely rough around the edges, a brilliant man, but a tough individual who once said he would run over his own grandmother if that's what it took to reelect Richard Nixon. But he got into trouble with the law, and you've heard of Watergate, and he wound up being incarcerated. But before he went to prison, Jesus went to him, we might say. And in quite a remarkable story, this man who was so rough around the edges was converted and gave his life to Christ, and later went on to have a very wonderful prison ministry known as Prison Fellowship. And he wrote his biography called Born Again. And someone asked him why he wrote his biography, and this is what he said: "What motivated me to write was that my disgrace was not the end of the story, or even the main part of the story. The real story was that Christ had reached down to me, even in my disgrace and shame, and revealed himself as the one who forgives and makes new. Born Again is the story of a broken man transformed by the love and power of Jesus Christ, who continues to transform me every passing day." I think we all could say the same thing, can't we? God is good. Glory be to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all God's people say. Amen. Let's stand and sing together. Please be seated.
Once again, we would like to welcome you to Stevens Valley Church. We are so glad that you're with us on this Lord's Day. If you're in the center aisle here, would you please pass the attendance pad? If you'd sign in and let us know of your attendance today, we would greatly appreciate that. As far as announcements, I'd just call your attention to your bulletin. Jim covered most of them earlier in the service. There is a conspicuous little black box near the top of the page. It's self-explanatory as far as the way it's described in the bulletin, I hope, but that's just a convenient way for you to give online through your cell phone. With that said, we will now receive God's tithes and our offerings.
In this quiet place with you, I bow before your throne. I bear the deepest part of me to you and you alone. I keep no secrets, for there is no thought you have not known. I bring my best and all the rest to you and lay them down. With all my heart, I want to love you, Lord, and live my life each day to know you more. All that is in me is yours completely. Serve you only with all my heart. You faithfully supply my needs according to your plan. So help me, Lord, to seek your face before I seek your hand. Then trust you know what's best for me. When I don't understand, then follow in obedience in every circumstance. With all my heart, I want to love you, Lord, and live my life each day to know. With all my heart.
All thy works shall praise thy name, O Lord, and we pray that this work, these gifts, likewise will praise your name. We love you, albeit imperfectly, but we do because you first loved us and given your Son for us. And so take these gifts, improve our love, multiply these tithes and offerings that people far and wide would come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Well, I'd invite you to turn with me now to the 137th Psalm. We'll be finishing our summer in the Psalms this morning. Before I read this passage, let me pray for us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. It is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We pray that you would illumine our minds, that you would send your Holy Spirit now for Jesus Christ's sake. Help us to read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest your holy and inspired word, for we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Psalm 137. By the waters of Babylon, there we sat down and wept when we remembered Zion. On the willows there, we hung up our lyres, for there our captors required of us songs and our tormentors mirth, saying, "Sing us one of the songs of Zion." How shall we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand forget its skill. Let my tongue stick to the roof of my mouth if I do not remember you, if I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy. Remember, O Lord, against the Edomites, the day of Jerusalem, how they say, lay it bare, down to its foundations. O daughter of Babylon, doomed to be destroyed, blessed shall he be who repays you with what you have done to us. Blessed shall he be who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock. All flesh is grass, and all its loveliness is as the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Amen. Well, the Psalms have been called the hymn book of the Bible. And as with modern hymns, you have your favorites and you have your not favorites. And this has probably been a lot of people's not favorites in the hymn book of the Psalter. It's very, very dark. It's vengeful. It's angry. You know, there's a line in the Princess Bride, Inigo Montoya, the great character. He says, after he's venged the death of his father, he says, "I've been in the revenge business so long. Now that it's over, I don't know what to do with myself." And here's the question before us. First off, let's at least give the psalm a try. Let's at least give it the benefit of the doubt. And I think that if we do, we will actually show that this psalm, we will actually see that the psalm of anger and rage and vengeance can actually teach us how to deal with anger and rage and vengeance. So how do you deal with anger, according to Psalm 137? 3 points. You take your anger to God, you leave your anger to the Messiah, and you put your anger in book 5. Number one, take your anger to God. The context of this psalm is the Babylonian exile. Jerusalem has been largely destroyed. The temple has been burned. The best and the brightest of Judah have been deported and taken to the kingdom of Babylon to serve King Nebuchadnezzar. And the people of Israel are brought into exile. So imagine being deported from your homeland, set up in a strange land, and then what happens? That beautiful phrase, there by the streams or by the rivers of Babylon, their captors, their tormentors, require mirth of them. And they say, "Sing us some of you Israelites, you're famous for your songs, you're famous for those David songs. for those Zion songs, for those psalms. Sing us one of those joyful songs of Zion. And this is just, you know, rubbing salt into the wound, so to speak. They're just goading the Israelites. And you ask the question, okay, you put yourself in that position. Everything you love has been destroyed. Probably your family's been ripped apart. And you're in sorrow. And here are your captors, your tormentors, demanding of you mirth, demanding of you joyful songs. What do you do? Well, as I see it, you have two choices. Either you comply and you stuff that anger and you stuff that rage and you eat it and you comply, or you lash out and you try to get revenge immediately, which is not going to work out too well for someone who's been taken into captivity. Stuff it, eat it, or lash back out in return. As a pastor friend of mine was preaching on a passage in 2 Samuel this week, and we were discussing it, and I think it's a good illustration of how people tend to deal with anger. 2 Samuel 16, there's a man in King Saul's family named Shimei, and he is angry at David because he blames David for the death of Saul and the death of Saul's son and the death of many of Saul's relatives and the downfall of Saul's kingship. And so David is marching back in from a victory in battle, and Shimei gets word, and he goes out and he starts cursing David loudly in front of all of his military commanders, in front of a large chunk of the army. And not only does he start cursing David, he starts picking up rocks and throwing them at David. And again, in front of the head of David's army, his general standing right at his right hand. And not only does he throw rocks at David, he starts kicking up the dirt, throwing dirt in the air, you know, like you've seen a baseball umpire. A coach gets really mad at a bad call and comes out and starts kicking dirt, turns his hat backward, gets right in the umpire's face. This is what Shimei was doing to David in the passage, throwing a temper tantrum, a hissy fit. That's what my mom probably would have called it. And David has a choice. So this man has lashed out at me in anger. I have all the authority over him. I'm the king. My general's standing with his sword at my right hand, and the general's standing there saying, "Let me smoke this guy. Let's take him out." And David says, "No. Perhaps what he's saying has come from the Lord. We will let God sort this out in the end." And he took a vow that he would never lay a hand on Shimei. So Shimei, on the one hand, he's the lash out, get revenge, curse him in front of everybody, kick the dirt and throw the rocks. And David, what does he do? He's the opposite. He stuffs it. He just takes it. And you think, well, what David is doing there is the more godly example, right? Not to act out on your rage. And then you get, we're into some shocking passages today. When you get to the end of King David's life, literally his deathbed speech to his son Solomon. Solomon's going to succeed him as king. And this is in 1 Kings chapter 2. These are David's last recorded words in the story of the life of David. 1 Kings chapter 2, starting in verse 8. He says to Solomon, "And there is also with you Shimei, the son of Gera, the Benjaminite from Bahurim, who cursed me with a grievous curse on the day when I went to Mahanaim. But when he came down to meet me at the Jordan, I swore to him by the Lord, saying, 'I will not put you to death with the sword.' Now, therefore, do not hold him guiltless, for you are a wise man. You will know what you ought to do with him, and you shall bring his gray head down with blood to Sheol." Here's my last charge to you, son, future king of Israel, new king of Israel. Take that guy to hell, no matter what you do. He wasn't like Shimei. He didn't just start throwing rocks, right? But even King David, he ate it. He held on to that anger. And here it is years later, on his deathbed, it's still simmering in him. There's this one guy who did that one thing to me, and I just can't get over it. And so he passes on that anger and that rage to his son. And you can continue reading the story. It's interesting how Solomon treats him in the wake of this. So when you get to our passage in Psalm 137, what you'll notice about the psalmist is he's not throwing rocks and slinging dirt. He's not saying, "God, I'm going to pick up the sword and I'm going to fight these guys." He's not lashing out in rage, but he's also not just stuffing the anger against the Babylonians either. What's he doing? He's praying. That's what the psalms are. They're prayers. He's taking it to God. He's basically laying out a case before God, and he's saying, "Here's what they have done. They took us into captivity. They've tormented us. They've mocked us. God, do something about this. I'm putting this in your hands and trusting that you will do justice. More than that on a minute. But first, let me say something about praying your anger and taking your anger to God in prayer. Years ago, I heard a sermon on Psalm 72 that King Solomon prayed about the expansion of his kingdom. And it's a ridiculous prayer where he's praying, God, take the kingdom of Israel and spread it all over the earth. Let all the nations come and pay tribute before the king and all these things. And the preacher made an application of that he said, sometimes you need to pray outlandish prayers. You need to pray really big prayers. You need to take your deepest wishes, hopes, dreams, longings, and you actually need to tell God what they are. And I was convicted about it. And I remember I was listening to this in my office, a former secular job, and I went out to my car on my lunch break, and I went and I prayed for about 30 minutes, and I realized in that moment I had all these inner things that I wanted to do and wanted to achieve and wanted to see happen in my life that were so personal to me that I couldn't even tell God about them. And I told him that day, and I counted it as a major turning point in my life in a lot of ways. Now, if your hopes and dreams and ambitions, the good things, can be so personal that they're hard to tell to God, how much more can the disappointments and the anger and the rage and the chaos, the wounds, you know, wounds that can be so personal. It's hard to talk to anybody about them, much less to God. And we need the reminder, he knows what we need before we ask for it. He knows us completely. He knows all the anger. He knows all the rage. And if we're believers in Christ, he still loves us. And like the book of Hebrews says, that we can boldly approach the throne of grace to find help in time of need. You can take this stuff to God. He's big enough to handle it. He's not going to be... I heard another minister say years ago that when you're a parent, you need to parent in this way. Don't ever let anything your children tell you they did shock you, because they're capable of doing anything. We all are. God knows what we're capable of doing. He knows what's going on inside of us, and we shouldn't be afraid to go to him. Imagine you're a parent. We're going to say, for the sake of story, a father. And your little child has been relentlessly bullied by a kid at school, has been beaten up, has had dirt kicked on them, sand kicked in their face, had terrible derogatory things said about them by this bully. And they don't come to you. They don't tell you. This your child. And one day you're sitting at the dinner table and your child just starts sobbing uncontrollably and bellowing. And you say, what's wrong? What's wrong? And then it starts to come out, and the child says, I've been dealing with this terrible bully for weeks and weeks, and it's eating me alive. And I didn't want to tell you because I didn't want to feel like a weakling. And what's the dad going to say? Why didn't you come talk to me about this? We could have talked about this. We could have come up with a plan. We could have done something. And if an earthly parent will do that, how much more will your heavenly Father? You come to him. You don't have to lash out. You don't have to stuff it. You can come directly to him. Steve Brown says, the next time you see a child fall and scrape his or her knee, watch what happens. The little girl or boy will be picked up by mom or dad, and in that moment, there will usually be silence before the storm breaks. Do you know what is happening? The child is making sure someone is there to hear, that he is in the parent's arms before he screams. See, the psalmist knows, God is there to hear my screams, even when no one else is. Imagine if you went to the book of Psalms, this book that's meant to teach you how to pray, and all you found was, there is sunshine in my soul today. Everything is perfect. Thank you, God. I'm so filled with joy. I'm over the clouds. I'm dancing on the moon. It's all rainbows and kitty cats and lollipops. Would you take this book seriously? This is teaching you how to pray? No, thank God for the darkness, because it's showing us we're not in strange company. Douglas Stewart said, part of the good news of the Psalms is that you can't out-misery them. Derek Kidner said, the presence of such prayers in Scripture is a witness to God's understanding. God knows how men speak when they are desperate. Nothing you bring to God is going to shock him. Do not be afraid to take your anger to God. You don't have to lash out. You don't have to stuff it. You can take it to God. And here's the next step. You can take your anger to God. You can leave your anger to the Messiah. So the darkest part of the passage in Psalm 137 is verses 8 and 9. O daughter of Babylon, doomed to be destroyed, blessed shall he be who repays you with what you have done to us. Blessed shall he be who takes your little ones and dashes them against the rock. There's a key phrase repeated there. Blessed shall he be. This is a callback to the very beginning of the book of Psalms, to Psalm 1. How does it start? Blessed is the man. It's the exact same Hebrew phrase. Blessed shall he be who walks not in the counsel of wicked, who stands not with scoffers, sits not with scorners, but instead his delight is in the law of God, and on it he meditates day and night. It's a callback to Psalm 1. In verse 9, he says, blessed shall he be who dashes the little ones against the rock. That word dash is only used one other time in the book of Psalms, and it's in Psalm 2. And it's talking about the Messiah. It's talking about God's king. It says, kiss the son, lest in the day of his vengeance he dash you into pieces like a potter dashes clay. The book of Psalms is about the messianic king and his kingdom. The blessed one, the righteous one, God's king who is going to judge the earth in righteousness. And if you've read the book of Revelation, you know that the enemies of God and his people are called Babylon. This is a micro picture of a big macro story of what God is doing in the world. Babylon was a real nation, but it became a picture of the wickedness of the world. In the book of Psalms, God is promising, yes, the people of God are going to have enemies. They're going to have enemies worthy of being dashed into pieces like pottery. But God is going to send his king, and his king is going to administer justice in the world. His king is going to repay every evil that's ever been done, and he's going to judge. He's going to separate the sheep from the goats, the good from the bad, the good guys from the bad guys, so to speak. And that's why in the New Testament, Romans 12, Paul says, beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. Leave it. Leave that vengeance. Leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. See, God has, the reason you don't have to lash out at your enemies and get vengeance is because you can trust in Christ's hand that he's going to judge rightly, that he's going to judge better than you would judge. The Croatian, he's in America now, but he's a Croatian theologian, Miroslav Volf. He says that Americans have been so insulated from atrocity in some ways that we've come up with this strange idea that we can say we don't believe in a God, particularly in a God who is a judge and will judge evildoers, and yet still somehow not continually be seeking vengeance on evildoers. And his quote is, he says, it can take the quiet of a suburban home for the birth of the thesis that human nonviolence corresponds to God's refusal to judge. In a scorched land soaked in the blood of the innocent, it will invariably die. What he's saying there, if you take away a God who is a judge, a Messiah who you can leave your wrath with, when people do wrong, someone is going to have to administer wrath. Someone's going to have to right the wrongs, and who's it going to be? Probably going to be you or someone you know, God forbid. And, you know, John Lennon's song Imagine has become like a quasi-national anthem in our country. Imagine there's no heaven, above us only sky. Imagine all the people living for today, right? You take, if above us is only sky, then there is no hope of ultimate cosmic justice, right? Whatever Hitler did, who cares? The strong eat the weak. That's Darwinism. That's the way of the world. You end up, Wolf is saying, the end of that line of thought is, we all start becoming the gods who have to administer judgment. We have to be the ones who take out our vengeance on the evildoers. We have to get in the revenge business, and it's an ego Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die. And you end up living the rest of your life like that. You're David on your deathbed saying, I took a vow to the Lord. I'm not going to kill this guy, but I didn't say that my son wouldn't. Some of my favorite movies and stories are vengeance stories. Princess Bride is somewhat of a vengeance story. Tombstone is a vengeance story. That's one of my favorites. You know, I love Doc Holliday going after Johnny Ringo and paying him back for all the evils he's done. But you know how that movie ends, and you know how every vengeance movie ends? A lot of death. A lot of blood. Vengeance stories always end in blood. And the Bible is telling us, you take your anger to God. You leave your anger to the Messiah. You don't seek revenge. You leave it into the hands of someone who's a better judge than you. And then finally, put your anger in book 5. There's still a danger when you leave your anger to the Messiah that you can become someone who's constantly calling down God's wrath. Jesus can become something of an attack dog in your theology, where it's like, well, I can't get him, but Jesus, you get him. And that's probably not the mindset we want to go walking around with on a normal day-to-day basis, though at times it might be appropriate and healthy. Like, you know, the last prayer of the Bible, come Lord Jesus, becomes come Lord Jesus and get all these terrible people so that I alone can go to heaven. The book of Amos has a warning to people who think like that. It says, this is Amos 5:18, woe to you who desire the day of the Lord. Why would you have the day of the Lord? It is darkness and not light, as if a man fled from a lion and a bear met him, or went into the house and leaned his hand against the wall and a serpent bit him. God is saying through Amos there, he's saying, be careful leaning too hard on the wall of justice and revenge, because you might find there's a snake crawling on the pillar that's going to bite, you know, the serpent that you hoped would bite them might end up biting you. That's kind of his warning. And that's why the placement of Psalm 137 is so important. I talk about this. I try to do it at least once a year in our series on the book of Psalms. My Sunday school class has talked about it recently. But something I learned in seminary that transformed the way I look at the book of Psalms was that in the last 50 years, there's been some advances in the study of the book of Psalms and what has been called the canonical view of the Psalter. What does canonical mean? It's talking about canon, and we're not talking about a cannon that a pirate uses to shoot. We're talking about canon as in a book. And so what these people studying the book of Psalms have said is, we've tended as Christians to look at the book of Psalms as like a bunch of random poetry, right? And you find ones that you like, you find your favorite hymn, and you memorize that, and you kind of ignore the ones that you don't like. Psalm 23, yes. Psalm 137, no. And they said, we need to start taking the book of Psalms more seriously as a book that has a message, like any other book in the Bible, has a complete message. And what they have found, and the Bible Project, just YouTube, the Bible Project, they have a great video on an overview of the Psalms that explains this to some degree, better than I have time to do right now, if you want to look that up. But basically, my summary is, Psalms is divided into 5 books. There are 5 books in the Psalms. You look and you flip through the pages of the book of Psalms in your Bible, they will be there. It will say book 1 over the first part of Psalms, book 2, book 3, etc. Books 1 through 3 of the Psalms that ends with Psalm 89 are about the rise, struggle, and ultimately fall of the kingdom of Israel, and specifically of David's kingship. And then as you get to Psalm 90 in book 4, Book 4 is about exile. The people of God, the crown has fallen into the dirt. The people have gone into exile. The Davidic kingship appears to have ended. And so you go back to Moses in Psalm 90, and he says, oh Lord, you've been our dwelling place in all generations. The people are homeless, and they're having to remind themselves that ultimately God is their home. Then when you get to book 5, after this period of exile, and you get return, you get the Psalms of Ascent, where the people are marching back to Zion, and are singing happy songs of joy and praise. And the book of Psalms, you read the last 5 Psalms, it's just praise. Everything's great. It is sunshine in my soul today. Praise, 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 praise. So you get the rise and fall of the kingdom. You get the kingdom in exile in book 4. And you get praise, 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 marching to Zion in book 5. And so I have puzzled for a number of years with that understanding of the book of Psalms. Of Psalm 137 is the most stark psalm in the Psalter. What book should it be in? It should be in book 4. It should be like Psalm 93. It should be in that area where the people of God are in exile in Babylon. It fits perfectly there. And so I keep asking the question, well, if it's true that the Bible is really, if the Psalms is really laid out like this, why is it in book 5? Why is it in the happy book? Why is it surrounded by all these beautiful psalms that are proclaiming the Lord's victory and the return from captivity? Here's the answer I came up with. I was studying the life of David for my Sunday school class, and it just hit me one day that this Psalm 137 belongs in the happy book, book 5, because it's so dark, it has to be surrounded by light. It's so violent, it has to be surrounded by peace. It's so sad, it has to be surrounded by worship. It so embodies the exile and sufferings of the people of God that we have to look at it through the perspective of the people being set free from their captivity and marching back to Zion. Their lyres are no longer hung up on the willow trees. They're coming back into the presence of their king in a restored kingdom. What that teaches us, ultimately, is that we have to look at all of our anger, all of our rage, all of our longing for vengeance in light of something we've seen that the exiles never saw. Even in being brought back to the land, they didn't see it. And that is that most of us are Gentiles. It's easy to put yourself in the story and be like, yes, I'm the Israelites and the Babylonians are my enemies. But most of us are Gentiles. And in the view of ancient Israel, we're probably the ones who deserve being bashed against the rocks. And of course, then we come to the New Testament and here comes Jesus Christ, God's little one, God's only begotten Son, who comes to do what? To be dashed in pieces for us. Because we deserved vengeance. We leave it to the Messiah. The Messiah, he could have come and dashed us into pieces like pottery. That's what Psalm 2 says. But instead, he comes to be dashed in pieces for us. Now, the only rock we'll ever be thrown against is the rock that is Jesus Christ. And you know, the New Testament says that rock can be one of two things. It can be a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. Or it can be a cornerstone of salvation. And the choice is in our hands right now. And one of my favorite quotes, this was on my desktop of my computer for years, was Charles Spurgeon. He said, this is how you deal with trials. This is how you deal with anger. This is how you deal with vengeance. This is how you deal with trouble. He said, I've learned to kiss the wave that casts me against the rock of ages. You take all your anger, you put it in book 5. You put it in light of Christ's coming, of his living, of his dying, of his rising from the dead, of his promising that he's going to return again. You take all that darkness and you throw it into the light of Christ. You take all that anger and you throw it against the rock of ages. And that's how you learn to deal with anger. Martin Lloyd-Jones said, take all your anger and paint over it with the blood of Christ. And you know, it's easier said than done. I deal with it myself. I'm not flawless. Plenty of anger in my life. But this is, it's a process over and over again. You take it, you cast it against the rock. You take it, you cast it against the rock. You put it in book 5. And when you do this, you know, when the editors of the book of Psalms put this in book 5, it was so brilliant. Like, I was listening to a TED talk a while back by a lady named Sarah Montana. It's called The Real Risk of Forgiveness. This is a young lady whose mother and brother had been murdered by a teenage neighbor who had broken into their house to steal some things, had been caught. He freaked out because he was caught, and so he shot them. And this is 15 years removed from the murder or whatever, and this lady is saying, she's telling the story of her journey toward forgiving this guy. And one of the things she said she studied the Bible, she studied Jewish wisdom, she studied all the modern self-help things, and she said the greatest thing she came to realize was that, quote, when we choose vengeance, we're signing a blood oath to chain our story to our enemy's story for the rest of time. When you're David holding a grudge to your grave, you're taking this great legacy you have as king, and you're saying, I'm going to tie myself to my enemy, and his story will always be a part of my story. And she said, so this Sarah Montana, she said she realized every time I think about my mom, it's always in connection with her murderer. They had hitched themselves, in my mind, they were hitched together. And she said, what you do when you forgive someone, you know, there is freeness in being forgiven, and there is also great freeness in forgiving, because it's you saying, I refuse to chain myself and my story to that person who wronged me. In other words, I'm not in Babylon anymore. I'm marching to Zion. And those Babylonians, they can stay there. I'm not going to allow them to chain themselves to me so that I have to drag them around. You know, there's another graphic line in the New Testament in Romans 7 where Paul says, praise to God, who will deliver me from this body of death? That was torture in the ancient world on ships for captives, was they would actually chain another person's dead body to yours and you would have to carry it around. It's carrying, and that's what unforgiveness is. It's you carrying dead weight. It's you carrying someone else around. And when you forgive, there's amazing freedom to be found. You say, Babylon doesn't define me. Zion is my joy. I belong in a better place and I belong to a better person. Not every hymn is going to be your favorite hymn. I hope Psalm 137 has something to say to you. In a few moments, we're going to sing a hymn that is not, well, we're going to sing, Micah is going to sing a hymn that is not my favorite hymn, which is In the Garden. I heard Thomas Long, who's a seminary professor and preacher, tell a story where he said, quote, my least favorite hymn is I Come to the Garden Alone. It has saccharine lyrics and a la-di-da tune. Other than that, it's fine. So some of you might know the experience of Tex Sample about this hymn. He taught at a seminary in Kansas City, and he was talking about how terrible of a hymn I Come to the Garden Alone is. He was dancing around the room, making fun of the melody. Everyone was laughing, or so he thought. After class, a 35-year-old woman approached him and said, Dr. Sample, please don't ever do that again. And he said, why? And she said, starting at age 11 and continuing till I was big enough to fight back, my father abused me. And after those horrible experiences, I would go outside to the garden, and the only freedom I could find, and I would remember that hymn, he walks with me, he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. See, that's saying, I will not live in book 4. I can find the freedom of book 5. I will not be captive. Because when you are captive, the person who's wronged you says, you are mine. I've hitched my story to you forever. The freedom that forgiveness gives is that now Jesus Christ comes to you and says, no, you don't belong to them. You belong to me. He tells me I am his own. Let us pray. Father, thank you for the abundance of your grace toward us who believe. And I know this has been a heavy time and a heavy subject and a lot of darkness, but Father, the light of the gospel so outshines the darkness that the darkness cannot comprehend it. So help us to walk in Christ's light. Help us to walk in Christ's freedom, and help us to hear the voice falling on our ear that says, you are my own. For we ask it in Christ's name. Amen. So we come now to the Lord's table. Just for visitors and for those who need a reminder, as these trays pass through the aisles, you'll only pick up what appears to be one cup, but it's two cups stacked together, one inside the other. You'll pull them apart, and there you'll have the elements. This table is a table for believers. It is not Stevens Valley Church's table. It is not your minister's table. This is the Lord's table. So if you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, then come and welcome, for this is his table. This is his meal for his people. If you are not a believer, then if you are still living in Babylon, so to speak, and are in rebellion against the Lord, we would ask you to refrain from these elements, because the Apostle Paul gives us warnings in the New Testament that this table should not be partaken of unworthily by those who are in disbelief. Even for believers who are in egregious sin and who refuse to repent, this table can be a snare. So I urge you, non-believers, repent, come to the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, but let these elements pass. And for believers, repent and come to the Lord Jesus Christ, and let these elements be a nourishment and a spiritual refreshment to you. In this table, in these elements, the body and blood of Christ, it's just one more way, one very sure and vivid way in which Jesus says, you are my own. and the joy that we are going to share as we tarry here, none other has ever known. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same manner, after the supper, he took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for the remission of sins. Drink from it, all of you. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Never.
Let's stand together and sing hymn number 504, We Will Feast in the House of Zion. Now the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all as we continue this, our short earthly pilgrimage. And all God's people say, Amen. Amen.